part of the first episode of the guest lecture series organized by the Astronomical Society of the University of Pennsylvania. As you all know, today's lecture will be conducted by our guest speaker, Mr. Janaka Adasurya, who is a senior research scientist of Arthur C. Clarke Institute for Modern Technologies. Well, it is a great pleasure to see you all joining with this event, and I believe your interest towards the astronomy has paved you to do so. Astronomy is a very interesting subject since the times of great scientists such as Nicholas Copernicus and Galileo Galilei, the hunger to unravel the unknown knowledge and mysteries that lie beneath the deep space had continued by various parties, and now we have arrived to an era in which the involvement of sophisticated technologies has taken place. Not too long ago, we were able to witness the images of a black hole, M11. And this year's Nobel Prize for Physics was awarded for the discovery of a supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy. So it's quite evident how much of an impact that the astronomy has brought into this present world. And for all these, the foundation was laid back in history. So without wasting any further more time, we will get on with the proceedings. Now I would like to invite the president of the Astronomy Society, Mr. Dilshan Abeykorn, to give away the welcome speech.
Thank you, Papa. Good evening, everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome you all for the first lecture of the guest lecture series organized by the Astronomical Society of University of Peradeniya for the year 2020. First of all, I would like to extend a special welcome to our guest speaker, Mr. Janaka Adasurya, who's a senior research scientist of the Arthur C. Clarke Institute for Modern Technologies. As the Astronomical Society, we are really appreciate your presence here on such a short notice. Next, I would like to welcome our head of the department, Dr. Varuni Seniviratna, and also the senior treasurer of the Astronomical Society, Dr. T.P. Ranaka. Your hard work and the dedication was really helpful to make this event possible. Also, I would like to warmly welcome you all the lecturers, temporary staff members, and also all the undergraduate students of Faculty of Science. Next, let me briefly explain the objectives of this lecture series. The Astronomical Society organized this event to increase the interest of students toward the subjects of astronomy and physics. In this lecture series, our lecturers will be discussing about a variety of topics, such as birth of this astronomy to complex topics, such as complex topics from relativity and cosmology as well. At the end of the lecture series, you will have a good knowledge about astronomy. Finally, I would like to thank you all for your presence for today's event and hope you will take something out of this. Thank you.
Thank you, Dilshan. Now I would like to invite the senior treasurer of the Astronomical Society, Dr. T.P. Ranavakar, to address the gathering.
Thank you, Mr. Yapa. First of all, I must thank the Astronomical Society for taking the initiative in organizing the lecture series. And I must especially thank Mr. Janaka Adasurya for being kind enough to accept our invitation to be our guest speaker. It is indeed a great pleasure to introduce Mr. Janaka Adasurya, who is no stranger to our department. He and Mr. Saraj Gunasekara, senior research scientist of Arthur C. Clarke Institute, have helped us in numerous ways, especially guiding our final year physics honors students in their research projects related to astronomy. To give a brief introduction about Mr. Janaka Adasurya, Mr. Janaka obtained his BSc in physics honors in the University of Colombo in 2002 and completed his Master of Technology in Andhra University, Visakhapatnam, specializing in space and atmospheric science in 2015. He is currently reading for a PhD in astronomy, which will be completed in 2021. Mr. Janathi is a research scientist in the astronomy division of the Arthur C. Clarke Institute and has authored several papers pertaining to astronomy in peer-reviewed journals and has won several awards as well. He has made several conference presentations abroad in USA, Austria, India, Korea, as well as Bulgaria. He is also a visiting lecturer in the University of Moratuwa, Sri Jayawardenepura, and Sabaragamuwa, giving lectures in astronomy, cosmology, and space physics. So without further ado, let us invite our guest speaker, Mr. Janakada Surya, to present his talk on the history of astronomy. Thank you.
Okay. Good afternoon to everybody. First of all, I would like to thank for inviting me for such a very nice lecture series, a timely lecture series, especially now these days the graduates are at home, so they are looking for some other areas, and it's just sometimes get bored with the online lectures and all. So I think it's a very timely event organized by the Astronomical Society of Peradeniya. I should thank first to invite me for this event, and just to have a just to share the experience what I have actually achieved, as well as to discuss something really interesting topic in astronomy. So let me actually just begin this lecture in such a when we are looking at when we discuss about what type of topic we have to start, we have to just discuss at the beginning. So then I thought maybe then if we go for like a lecture series, so it is better to understand about the history, so better to know about our history. I mean, whenever you go to that, you are looking at what the people has done earlier, right? So what they have done earlier. So therefore, it is better to know, just to get some idea about how this thing actually developed, how this area actually developed, and what are the contribution the people have done for this area, and how they actually dedicated for this astronomy and those things. The very nice kind of a stories behind this. There are a lot of stories behind this. So I thought to give some sort of a brief introduction about the history of astronomy, especially specific time periods, the people who contributed very much to the astronomy and all. So I will give some essence of this history of astronomy today. So let me share my presentation slides with you. Okay. Yeah, I think you can see the presentation slides right now. Can you see the presentation slides? Okay. I hope.
No, sorry.
Is it not ready? Okay. No. Okay.
No.
Just a moment. Just a moment. Can you see now?
Yes, it's visible now.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Right. So now today we just discuss about the history of astronomy, especially how the astronomy as a subject, how actually it has developed up to the today's, I mean, we really know that we are in a very good the situation in astronomy, I mean, in technology, in science and all. So the astronomy is a very important subject at the moment to develop the technology, develop the science and introduce new concept in science and all these things. Astronomy is very important. So, but it has actually come a long way when you look at the past of history, right? It has come the long way. And we know that the astronomy is the oldest science in the world, oldest science in the world. So as well as the astronomy is the mother of all the sciences, because now we call that when you look at that astronomy, all the sciences are mathematics, you know that chemistry is also there now, people are actually just involving in astrobiology and all. So therefore, it is obviously we call that is a mother of science. Astronomy is a mother of science. So it's better to see what the people actually have done it earlier, like in past. So let me just ask you a question. When did mankind first become interested in science of astronomy? This is a very simple answer. You can get it from this. There are several options also. It is like 20th century, in time of relativity, or maybe you can say that some might actually think about the invention of telescope in 1600 years before, or maybe during the times of ancient Greek, like 400 to 300 years BC, or we can actually go for even beyond that, before that, the stone and the bronze age, several thousand years of BC. So actually, we exactly don't know where, when this astronomy has started, because when the sky is available and the people just look at the sky, right, from the beginning, so they had something in their mind why these actually stars actually glowing and how these stars actually moving and why these planets are actually moving in the sky, what are the patterns of moving. There are a lot of questions they actually had in their mind. So this is the start, however. So it is going to be several thousand years BC. Right, so that is the time we can think about. So then, what are the evidences in the world to what are the evidences in the world? We can actually find out a lot of evidences in the world to show that the astronomy has started very long time back. So can you identify this place in the world? This is a one place in the world. So maybe you are familiar with this place, right? This is called Stonehenge in UK, Great Britain, Stonehenge. Maybe you have seen in some of the films, some of the TV series. This is a very famous space taken for the TV series, even the films, right? You might actually recognize this place as Stonehenge. So you can see here, these are really huge stones, right? Just upright stones. Actually, this structure is a very big structure. It is not going to be a small one. You can see the people are here, right? This structure was actually there around this area, just spread out in a long area. But the remaining ones are only these huge stones right now. They are not just arbitrarily put. That's what they have found right now. These stones actually put according to some sort of alignment. The planetary alignment, or maybe they have actually found that these are actually aligned with the sunrise, sunset and all these things. So then the people had some idea about, they wanted to just express something, especially the sky observations or maybe planetary movements and all these things with this structure. So they have started about looking at the sky and then wanted to explain these movements of the sky objects. So this was constructed around maybe 3000 to maybe 1800 years BC before Christ in Great Britain. They just suspect that these are just actually alignment with the sunset, sunrise, moonset and moonrise and all these things These stones are aligned with to show those alignments. Probably they might use this as a calendar, because the calendar was not there. So the calendar actually came up very much later on that. So they should have some sort of an idea about to show the periods of the year, right? So therefore, this might be actually used as a calendar. So anyway, they have used the sky objects. They knew something about the movements of the sky objects during that time. So this is another example. There are a lot of examples around the world. I will just show you some of these. Bighorn Medical Wheel in Wyoming in USA. This is not that much of old, but 300 to 800 years ago. But it is also a very big structure. Just arrange these stone structure to show that sunrise, sunset, and all these things. Even the period of the time, time of the different time of the year. So they have aligned these things to show something about the sky movements. You know that the Maya culture, right? The Maya culture, approximately AD, 1000 AD, that means maybe 1000 years after Jesus Christ. So it is 1000 years actually. Now we are in 2020, about 1000 years, right? So therefore, here also, we can see there are a lot of structures they have actually built up, they have put up, but these structures also not just the structure. They want, these structures want to just align with some sort of a sky movements. Like now if you look at these windows are aligned to show the movements of Venus, then the other planets also. Some of the windows actually just align with the star movements during the year. So there are some sort of a relationship with the sky objects, movements of the sky objects. So they had some idea about astronomy. So this is another place in India, very close by, called Jantar Mantar, but that is around maybe 300 years old. But this structure is quite new. But anyway, this was actually built by another emperor in India at that time. This has a lot of monuments. Like anyway, when you look at this place, this is a sundial, right? The sundial is actually used to show the time during the day, right? So it's a very useful time, useful thing to show the time or during the day. And if you look at these two places, even they are semi-spherical kind of a structure. This is an underground structure. So actually, I personally visited this place. So I witnessed the structures as well. I mean, you can't imagine even how much the knowledge they had at that time to put up this kind of structures. Now, especially these two semi-spherical structures, if you stand on some place here, let's say in January or maybe June, then you can see how the sky actually objects move through the sky. This is actually reflecting the sky globe, but it is underground. So when you stand on some, let's say if you want to look at the January the sky, then you have to stand it somewhere here, right? So then it shows the planetary movements. So then you can't actually imagine how actually they build it. This is kind of a structure what we have at the moment. We have softwares, sky softwares. So the sky softwares also just predict the movements of the sky, future as well as past. So it is kind of thing, right? So there is another place we can see that how they had involved in astronomy. Okay, now in Sri Lanka, so is there any place in Sri Lanka also? We have about it, we have to find out. Of course, when you're going to find out the astronomy, the landmarks in astronomy in Sri Lanka, actually we don't see, we don't have many more places like in other countries like India or maybe the other European countries. But we have some evidences that people have maybe done something, maybe just try something. This is a one place. Some of you might be familiar with this place or maybe have visited also. This is Anuradhapura Ranmasuyana, right? In Anuradhapura Ranmasuyana, there's a huge structure. Just put it on the this stone wall, right? And the structure is something look like this. It has some symbols. Now this is a structure. This is the image of that. It has several symbols. The importance of this one is now we have a lot of symbols in our stone carvings. They're different type of structures, like maybe Muragala, or maybe sometimes we have seen Sandakata Pahana. There are a lot of very familiar structures like lotus leaf, or maybe a set of animals and all. But this is quite different. They just put some different symbols. There are 24 planetary symbols. The symbol is used to show the planets. Basically, when you look at the other structures in the world, usually this symbol is used to show the planets. So there are 24 planets, or the symbols similar to this. So they are showing some sort of a terrestrial symbols, extraterrestrial symbols, right? Or maybe something related to the sky. As well as you can see, at the center, there are semicircles, right? There are a set of semicircles. So this will usually show something like a planetary system, like our solar system, or maybe a different system. We don't know exactly. And some people had done extensive analysis of this, and they have given their expressions for this, maybe a kind of a idea that they had it earlier, different solar system, or maybe a planetary system or something like that. We don't know exactly. But however, we also have this structure in Anuradhapura, maybe a kind of a connection with the early astronomy. So these are the places. Then we will see how the people actually just contributed to astronomy from very early stage, like in how at these names like Thales, right? 624 BC contributed a calendar. A clear distinctions was drawn between us, which stage by the shift flow through the conscious. The Thales actually noticed that all the objects are moving from east to west, right? All the objects are moving during the night, east to west. So he noticed that during the year, planets are moving with respect to the stars in the other way, right? Slowly shifting. So usually in the night time, you see that all the planets, including stars and planets, they are moving from east to west, right? Rising from east and then setting from west. But at the same time, during the year, when you go for the different months, so these planets are slowly shifting in the sky. So this was noticed very much earlier by Thales. Then Aristotle. So he was actually given the first practical proof of that the Earth is a globe, right? So we had the different ideas about the shape of the Earth. Some people say that is a flat, then some might say actually, some says that it is a cylindrical shape and all. So then the first impression actually given that the Earth is actually the shape of globe, it's given by Aristotle. Then Aristarchus, right? It is 2800 BC. Earth of a state of a merely planet moves around the sun in a period of 1 year. He also proposed the sun is stationary at the center of the universe. He applied the geometry to astronomy and showed it was possible to find the distance to the moon and relative distance to the sun and moon. So then this is the important thing, the geometry. Now people used they wanted to estimate the planetary distances, planetary scales, the diameter, the sizes, and all these things they wanted to find out. Then slowly what happens, the mathematics involved in that, the geometry, spherical geometry, trigonometry, and all these things started introducing and started just involving with astronomy. Then the Hipparchus. Hipparchus is considered the greatest ancient astronomical observer and by some greatest overall astronomer of antiquity. He was the first who measured the quantitatively and accurately the models, the motion of the sun and the moon. So he has given some sort of a very precise idea, accurate idea about the motion of the sun and the moon, right? His other reputed achievements including discovery of the measure of the earth precession. Now see that the earth precession is, I think you have some idea about what is earth precession, right? Earth precession is actually, it is a, if you take a rotation of a top, right? Maybe you can actually play with the top, right? There's a small thing you can just rotate it, even not a top, anything if you rotate it. So it will just, the axis of the rotation also slowly rotate, the axis of the rotation axis. Rotation axis also rotated slowly. So this is called the precession. The earth axis also just moves slowly, right? And how much is the precision usually? Anybody have some anybody has some guess about that? The how long will it take to go around one cycle? So it is going to be 26,000 years. Going to be 26,000 years. So therefore, it is a very long time period to go around one cycle, the Earth axis. However, it is slowly move the axis in the sky, relative to the movement, right? So however, people actually contributed in this way. Now, when you look at, I will just explain about the some aspects of astronomy also, because people thought about this way earlier. Now, this is the daily motion, right? The daily motion, that means all the stars actually move from east to west during a night, right? This is called the daily motion, stars movement. Now, we have observed, that is the Thales actually observed this one. They have noticed that with this daily motion, now everything actually moves from east to west during the year, the planets actually move slowly or shifting slowly with respect to the stars, right? Or the other way, from where to where? West to east, right? Planets are moving slowly, shifting with respect to the stars from west to east. This movement we call prograde motion, right? Prograde motion, this was observed long time back. Now, at the same time, when they look at it very carefully, they have seen that, they have observed that this kind of unusual movement as well. So it is not going to be a continuous prograde motion, but during some part of the year, these planets move again the usual direction called east-west direction, going backwards as well. And again, after another few months, then again follow the same way, the prograde motion. So this going backward motion is called the retrograde motion. Retrograde motion. So they have observed this one, but they could not explain, give a complete idea about, or maybe a model to explain this motion. Now see that people have observed, but they could not explain it. There's no model for that. So this is actual prograde motion of a planet. It's actual photographs taken, timely time sequence photograph. So it's a prograde motion, actual prograde motion. Now this is another way it can be. Sometimes the prograde motion can be look like this or not. So it's going back, however, and then again follow the same path, right? So this was there for a long time and nobody can explain this. So then, a person came, who is that? Ptolemy, right? The Ptolemy actually just tried to explain this retrograde, prograde motion and retrograde motion. So he introduced geocentric universe. So geocentric universe is Earth is at the center of the universe and all the objects moving around the Earth, right? So we are at the center, and all the objects, including the sun, is also moving around the Earth. So this is called the geocentric universe. And in geocentric universe, the Ptolemy says the system proposed that the path of the planet is a combination of motion of two cycles, path, circular paths. The planet's moving epicycles. Now, the epicycle concept he introduced because he wanted to give some idea or just to give some explanation for the the question they had in their mind very much, and nobody can solve it, that retrograde motion. So the epicycle concept was introduced. With the epicycle concept, he was able to explain this retrograde motion. So how he did that? Now, he said that while these planets are moving around the Earth, they are moving within the orbit, they are moving again with the small cycles within the orbit, right? Within the orbit, again move with the small cycles, that is called epicycles, right? So with that, now you can actually explain the retrograde motion. See that? Now this is the orbital movement, and it's going with the epicycles. So for a while, it goes backwards. So with respect to, when you look at from the Earth, with respect to the Earth, so this planet is going backward for a moment, for some time period. So then it is possible. So introductory explained the retrograde motion, the westward motion of the planets. So the Ptolemy system was considered the standard model of the universe. How long? 1,400 years. So this geocentric models was accepted 1,400 years. It's such a long time. So we were in a wrong idea, right? So until who came? Until Nicholas Copernicus came, right? Now what happens? Renaissance of astronomy. So that means a reappearing of rebirth of astronomy happens during his time. The Copernicus revolution. The Copernicus says, no, this is something wrong. So we have taken in the wrong direction. We have taken in the wrong way. The sun is at the center of the solar system, while all the planets are moving around the sun in circular orbits. He said circular orbits, right? Now this is the Copernicus actual original explanation is given. Sol means the sun, solar, right? It came from that. He's a Polish astronomer. Copernicus was there for 1472-73 to 1543, and he introduced the heliocentric universe, sun at the center. But the problem is, he could not explain this because of the well-established geocentric theory, and everybody was accepted that, even the church. Right, the church is very strong that time. Even the Rome, the king, emperor, and all these people actually listen. They listen to the church, and the church was also say that the Ptolemy's model, geocentric model, is correct. Right, so no one can argue with that. So the Copernicus was really really frightened about that to introduce his theory. Or the publicizes theory about the heliocentric theory, sun is at the center. So he was actually kept it secretly and never just publicize it. He was a little bit scared about to tell it in open to the public. So this is the actual thing, but he knew that. So then Copernicus never introduce or never actually just publicize this heliocentric theory, but he just explained it clearly, the retrograde motion as well. Now if you at that time, because the most important argument is that the Ptolemy was able to explain the retrograde motion, There was a very big question at that time. So therefore, it is very difficult to break that law, that argument. So anyway, Copernicus knew that since these actually moving in a circular orbits, see that, with a different speeds, that means the speed is actually decreases when the planet is going away from the sun. So they are going slowly away from the sun. So therefore, it is possible to explain the retrograde motion. So this is the way. The Earth is here, the mass, and the relative position in the sky is somewhere here. So Earth is here, and the mass is here. So therefore, when the Earth is overtaking the mass, then for a short time, the relative position in the sky seems to be that Earth, the mass is going backward for a short time. So that is the retrograde motion. In heliocentric model, the rotation of the Earth explains the diurnal motion of the celestial objects. The Earth revolution around the sun explains the annular motion, and the retrograde motion of the planet occurs naturally when the Earth passes or is passed by another planet. This is just a relative movement of the planets in the sky when with the different velocities in their orbits. So this was new, right? He was actually confirmed that, but no one actually just talk about the Copernicus revolution until who came. Now see that how the astronomy has developed from stage to stage, right? So one person actually just remains something, and then the other person has taken it up and then solved it, some part of that. Now, the Galileo came to the picture. So that is called, what do you call, observational, start of observational astronomy. Why? Some people say that the Galileo invented the telescope. That's wrong. Galileo did not invent the telescope. He used the telescope to observe the sky. So the telescope was invented by an optician called Hans Lippershey. So anyway, so the father of observational astronomy, he called the Galileo is the father of observational astronomy, because the observational astronomy was started by this time with the invention of the telescope. While he did not invent the telescope, he was the first to use the telescope for astronomical observation, right? So he had some sort of a magnification, very small telescope. This is a one of the telescope he has used it. So these things are preserved in museums very much, very well, right, in France. So you can see these are there in the all these early stage instruments that people use. Most of the things are actually preserved nicely. So discovered that there were many stars not visible to the naked eye as well. Now he has a great time with the telescope, right? Nobody, because everybody has look at the sky with the naked eye, and the limitations are much more. So therefore, he has a unlimited facility kind of thing to observe the sky. So he has seen a lot of things in the sky, and these are some observations of Galileo. Discover the mountains and the plains in the moon. Discover face of the Venus, faces of the Venus similar to the moon. Now this is a very good discovery, very important discovery he made. Why? Even Galileo knew that the Copernicus was correct, right? But the Galileo was treated very nicely because he was kind of a philosopher, mathematician, as well as a well-known astronomer. So the Galileo was treated very nicely by the emperor as well as the church somewhere. So he was a very strong character. So, but he knew that Copernicus was correct, but he was looking at it, how we going to prove it. So this is the proof, right? So he discovered the face of the Venus, right? When we look at the Venus from the different angles, we will see it as new crescent gibbous of full. Now, we already know that the moon has a set of faces from the new moon to the full moon, right? There are different faces. Similarly, Venus also shows these phases, right? Only through the through the observation of the telescope, the Galileo was able to see this, right? He was able to see that these phases. Now, see, this is the phases of the Venus, half, maybe a crescent Venus, half Venus, and the full Venus like that. Now, this is the evidence of, or just the proof of heliocentric theory. Now, how he proved it. This is very nice idea. Now, at the same time, we know that Venus is actually, that is seen just before the sunrise and just after the sunset. Venus, we call Irabata Taruwa, in Sinhala Irabata Taruwa, Pahan Taruwa. Why we call? Because it is just before the sunrise, seen just before the sunrise, or it is just after the sunset. But you can't see after 7 o'clock, right? In midnight, or maybe 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, midnight, there's no way of seeing Venus, right? There's no way of looking at the Venus, right? So that is well known. So the observers knew that very much, right? That's a fact. Now, with this one, Galileo look at it. Okay, now if you keep the Earth at the center, while all the planets are moving around the Earth, including Venus and Sun is just moving around the Earth, little away from the Venus. Now these phases are possible. Now look at this. Now this phase is like a crescent Venus. Crescent Venus. When it comes to this point, right? So if I use maybe a pointer like this, like if you come to this place, it is going to be a half Venus. And if you come to this place, if the Venus come to this place, this is little bit more than half. And when it comes to this, it's going to be full Venus, full phase, right? Like full moon, it's a full Venus. So then it is possible, but the problem is, now this is the night side of the Earth. Now when the observer is somewhere here, it is exactly the night side, 12 o'clock, midnight, right? Midnight. So midnight, then you would be able to see full phase of the Venus. But can we see? No, there's no way. It's a well-known fact that there's no way of seeing Venus after 7 o'clock or just before 5 o'clock or 4 o'clock, not possible to see, right? So therefore something wrong with this completely. So then he came to this one. Okay, Copernicus, sun center, keep the sun center and the Venus is inner orbit and the Earth is outer orbit. Of course, all the phases are possible. So this is a new Venus, no Venus, crescent Venus, half Venus, little bit bigger, that is gibbous, and the full Venus is also possible, right? But it is very close to the sun. It's very difficult to see, but anyway, it's practically, it can be, it is possible to see, right? Practically, it is a little bit difficult, but however, this heliocentric theory just say that all these phases are possible to see, even that is during the sunset or just after the sunset or before the sunrise. So no problem with that. The heliocentric theory is correct. So see that how people use that simple idea, right, to just to get that the truth out of that, right, to make the correct model. So just a very simple idea, the phases of the Venus, right? Okay, however, then he observed a lot of areas in the sky, including sun. He observed the sun using that small telescope. And this is the present picture. You can see a lot of sunspots are there. This is taken by SOHO mission. And this is original drawing of Galileo, right? Now, how nice is the drawing? See that? The sunspot, right? How nice is drawing? This is original picture, original image of Galileo's is preserved in that museum, right? So he has looked at the sun with a very clear view, right? And also, well-known Jupiter's moons, right? Galileo moons, four Galileo moons. So these are the original drawings of Galileo. Even he noticed that the position of the four Galileo moons, right, during the time. So he has noted it very nicely. So these are the discoveries of Jupiter and Galileo Galilei, and he has contributed a lot to the astronomy in this way. Now, Nicholas Copernicus says the planets are moving in a circular orbits. He said circular orbits, right? Then after Galileo Galilei, there's another character came to picture, well-known character, Johannes Kepler, in 1571 to 1630. Now, Johannes Kepler is a student of Tycho Brahe. Tycho Brahe is a Danish astronomer. He's a very a smart person, Tycho Brahe even. He has done a lot of things. He knew a lot of things and he has observed a lot of things, but he never he never actually exposed his discoveries to the world. He kept it secretly. Johannes Kepler was a smart student of him, but even he did not give to the Johannes Kepler, because the Kepler was really smart student, and then knows that it's given to the Johannes Kepler, he will definitely just use that information and then discover some lot of new things. However, Kepler was there. Kepler waited until the Tycho died, and then he took all the information about the planetary movements and then introduced well-known Kepler's laws, right? Well-known Kepler's laws. So then the Kepler says that, no, the planets are moving in elliptical orbits. See that how it's changed, right? The Copernicus says circular orbit. No, he said elliptical orbit. They are moving in elliptical orbit with a different speeds, right? So therefore, he also contributed slightly different way. And the Kepler was the first person just introduce some sort of a mathematical expression to the astronomy, mathematical expression. Now, these are the Kepler's three laws, right? You might know about the Kepler's law, second law, third law. Third law is especially a expression for a mathematical expression introduced to physics in astronomy, right? Sorry. However, now based on the Kepler's laws, he was able to derive the planetary distances and periods. These planetary distances are very much accurate with the present calculations. It is 99% accurate with the present calculation. So the Kepler was really nicely estimated, correctly estimated with his finding. But Kepler had a problem. Kepler say that P is a period in years. A is in astronomical units. If you put it that those two units, then K becomes one. He didn't know about what is this K, just a constant. But he knew that if you put in P in years and then A in astronomical units, K becomes one. So that's all. So it's correct. I will just maybe skip some of these slides because it is just a 1 hour. So this is about the seasonal changes to show that. The seasonal changes, it is not because of the orbit, the elliptical orbit. You know that elliptical orbits, it's getting closer to in one place, that is called perihelion, and then moving away from the point called aperihelion. So the season actually occurs not because of elliptical movements getting closer to the earth and away from the sun. It is just because of the tilt, 23.5 degree tilt, exactly, right? So this is about that. Right, now the Kepler, just for a moment. I think there's an animation in this slide. That's why it is just stuck it here. Yeah, there's an animation in this slide, so it's just not responding. So I will, for a moment, I will stop sharing for a moment. So I will stop the presentation and then come back again, right? For a moment, just to give a few minutes. I think it's not responding. Okay, I will get it again. Okay. Right. I think you can see again, right? Can you see the presentation slides? Hello?
We can see, yeah.
Okay, right, okay. Right, so we'll move on. So then the Kepler's laws actually introduced, and he introduced the elliptical orbits, and then planets move with the different speeds. The Kepler did not know why the planets are moving in elliptical orbit, even the circular orbit, why the, especially the planets are moving in circular orbits or elliptical orbits until the Newton comes, right? So the Newton actually came in 1643 to 1727. Then he introduced a lot of things to the astronomy as well as the physics, right? So especially he introduced the Newton's law of gravitation. So the, that is the first explanation about why planets are moving around the sun, right? Not even around the sun. Like if you take why the moon is actually moving around the earth, because of the gravitational pull, gravitational influence. So this was given by Isaac Newton, universal law of gravitation. We already know that very well. So then some part of the Kepler's questions actually sorted out by Newton, and he said that because of gravity, all these planets are moving around the sun, right? And even he was able to explain about the different orbits, like circular orbits, elliptical orbits, and what is the minimum speed to escape from a planet, escape from the Earth, right? The, that is the terminal escape velocity and all these things. So he was able to explain, right? And the most important thing is the Newton actually revisited the Kepler's third law. So then the Newton again derived the Kepler's third law, and he found that this K is not going to be a constant anymore. It is not going to be a constant. So he found that the K is going to be this 4 phi squared G M sun M planet. That means this is not a universal constant, but it depends on the two masses we consider. Then how the Kepler was successfully calculated the planetary distances and the orbital periods. Because of this. So the sun and the planet, if you take the mass, you already know that the entire solar system, the mass is the sun. 99% nine is the mass, the sun, right? So even though you take Jupiter, it is negligible. So if you just take sun and the mass of the planet, it is almost sun. So therefore the Kepler was survived in that calculation, right? No problem. Even you calculate with that constant, so there's nothing change. We don't have to worry about that because it is almost sun, so it is going to be like a constant. So this is how the evolution of the science or the astronomy, basically, right? Evolution. And Then the gravitational force of the Earth causes the centripetal acceleration of the Moon. So then the Newton was very well actually say that how these planetary movements, right? So even that the movements around the Earth, right, or around the other planets even. So then the revised Kepler's third law becomes the potential tool to determine the mass of the planets. Now that equation is very useful to determine the masses of the planets if you know the other parameters. And the Ptolemy and Copernicus cosmology is enclosed by the sphere of fixed stars, finite and bounded. Now Ptolemy, Copernicus, they say that the universe is finite, but the Newton's cosmos is infinite. Why he said that? Maybe you can imagine even the universal law of gravitation. So it is very simple to think about that. If you get the edge of the universe, now let's say according to the Copernicus and the Ptolemy, there should be a edge. There should be the end of the universe, limit, right? We don't know exactly what is beyond that, right? But anyway, according to the Newton, now it cannot be because all these masses are attracting towards inside, but there are no masses outside. So therefore, this mass cannot be stay at the edge. So therefore, it has to be attracted towards inside. So then the universe has to be collapsed, right? It cannot be expand or maybe a static universe. So therefore, he obviously say the universe is infinite. But nowadays, the well-known the understanding is the universe is expanding right now, right? Not all the things in the universe sat happily with the Newton's infinite universe. Newton also remains unconstant. The gravitational force, the universal law of gravitation also remains some sort of uncertainty, is the question marks to the world, right? So what is the one question? That is, how can we explain the precession of the perihelion of Mercury? Precision of the perihelion of Mercury. So this was a question, and it could not completely solved out by Newton's law of gravitation. So this is the precession of perihelion of Mercury. Now the new concept actually introduced for the gravity, but still we have some lack of understanding or the gaps, right? So the precession of perihelion of Mercury means this orbit of the Mercury. It's a elliptical, highly elliptical orbit. That orbit is shifting. It is slowly shifting in space. So this was observed very much early, and they have measured this. So the observed value is 574.10 arc seconds per Julian century, that is 400 years. But if you calculate this value using the gravitational law, you could not get this value, observational value. Always you end up with a lesser value. So then people thought about that, why this is. Is it something wrong with the gravitational law, right? Something like misunderstanding of gravitational law. But the gravitational law is perfectly okay, right? But still, there are some uncertainties, right? Or maybe some gaps in understanding. So it was there for a long time, right? Until the Albert Einstein came. Now we came to the modern astronomy right now in 1879 to 1955. So the Albert Einstein actually introduced completely a revolutionized idea, theory of relativity, right? So he has introduced the special theory of relativity in 1905 and general theory of relativity in 1915, right? So then he was able to solve this question, and actually he has done a slight change in the gravitational universal law of gravitation, and then sort out the problem of perihelion of Mercury, precession of perihelion of Mercury, right? So I just don't actually want to go for in detail about these things So the theory of relativity especially introduced the time dilation, length contraction, completely upside down concept in physics, right? General relativity introduced in 1915, and after the general theory of relativity, our understanding of gravity, right? Gravity is completely different. Now the present understanding is again still based on this Einstein theory of general relativity, the gravity understanding. So the gravity actually just as a result of general theory of relativity, the Einstein says that the light get bends the presence of masses. The light get bends with the presence of masses, or the objects can actually bend the light, the masses. So he says that the general relativity claims that the gravity is the warping of space and time, warping, or it distorts the space and time. The gravity is nothing else, but that is a distortion of space and time with the presence of masses. If you keep a mass on a space, the space is usually like a uniform, a fabric. It is not disturbed, right? It's a uniform area. But if a mass actually keep on the space actually get disturbed. Or he said that it's warping or distorting the space. So maybe a artistic concept of that to show that the idea may be the best way. So this is a uniform fabric in the space, just lay on one line, one layer. So if you keep a mass on here, so then the warping of space, so therefore the light has to travel in this path. The light cannot travel straight away. It has to follow a warped path or warped space. So therefore, that is the bending of light. So it is a very nice concept, right? However, we have now this, based on this, he introduced a lot of phenomena, right? Astronomical phenomena, which can be possible, right? At that time, which can be possible mean these things actually he was introduced by using mathematics like expressions. Nobody knew about, nobody has seen it. No evidence for that. So just a concept. But now we know that he is actually true. His concepts are real because he introduced the black holes, right? And the very high gravitational influence areas of very high gravitational influence in the universe. So here, this is a uniform space, right? And due to this very high gravitational influence, light get bends or distorted. So then we can see this kind of change in the sky, right? So we have taken pictures right now with the Hubble Space Telescope, and that is maybe the presence of black holes in these places in the sky, right? So therefore, and not only he introduced quasars, active galactic nuclei, the bending of light by gravity, also just introduced the gravitational lensing concept, right? And now, as a result of that, he introduced the gravitational waves. You might know that the gravitational waves, when we discovered the gravitational waves, now we have discovered the gravitational waves when? So in 2016, right? 2016, exactly after 100 years of general theory of relativity. He predicted the presence of gravitational waves 1915. So we took 100 years to detect it. Of course, he said that we won't be able to detect these gravitational waves because they are very weak. So we could not detect it at all. But however, after 100 years, we have to wait 100 years until the technology developed to detect such a tiny signal from the space, we call the gravitational wave by this experiment. Laser interferon gravitational wave observatory, LIGO experiment. So a group of researchers actually just discovered this. I think you know that, right? Anyway, so now we are in the modern astronomy, we are in the modern concept of gravity, that is a concept of general theory of relativity. We have different understanding of gravity right now. So I just pass these few slides because these are the results of the theory of relativity. This is the idea of that warping of space and time. It's a nice experiment. So if you keep a mass on this fabric, so the fabric gets actually just bent. Actually, this is due to the, again, gravity. But anyway, this is just a demonstration. So if you just want to pass a marble over here, so if this, this mass is not there, yeah, the marble actually passes straight away. But if you just put this mass over here, the marble actually get influenced by the gravity of this. That means a warping of space and time. It never goes out and it just captured by this mass and then finally collapsed to it. So this is because of the warping of space and time, right? So it is nicely demonstrated by that. Okay, so now this is, I wanted to show you a letter to the Einstein, because Einstein was actually genius, right? He was a very famous and he was a very smart genius person. I mean, compared to the other scientists, right? And still his discoveries are actually, his concepts are discovering and then proving, right? Still going on. And this is the letter sent it to him in 1907, June 6. Dear Mr. Einstein, your application for the doctoral has not been successful at this time, and as such, you are not eligible for the position of associate professor. While you are posted an interesting theory in your article published in Analemma de Physics, it's a general, maybe a journal, we feel that your calculations about the nature of light and the fundamental connection between the space and time are somewhat radical. Overall, we found your assumptions to be more artistic than actual physics. So this is sent by Professor Wilhelm Heinrich, PhD, Dean of Science, Bonn University, Germany. So see that how nice is that, right? Now, this is a very good understanding, good example that people who introduce to the world, so they are really thinking just out of the box, right? So always we are, most of them, we are in the within the frame, right? The frame actually created by somebody else, right? So all these people, if you think about the Newton, Einstein, or all these, they just think about outside, out of the box, out of the way, right? And at the beginning, at the first place, or initially, so they was actually treated very badly because of this radical or maybe funny concept kind of thing. But finally, we know that he was correct. And everything what he said at the moment is true with the present physics, his present, present understanding. But we don't know who is going to break this, right? So we have to wait. Somebody comes, or maybe some group, or maybe just to improve something, maybe just deviate from the Einstein's theory as well. So this is going on, right? However, so I just stop it here, my presentation. So anyway, we came from very long time and then we came to the present situation, and still this is going on continuously and then improving again and again, just introducing and just revising physics, mathematics, and all these sciences. So thank you very much for your attention. It's open for question anyway. So if I can answer your question, I will answer. But I am not actually, I don't know everything about astronomy, but so from my capacity, I will try to answer the questions. Okay.
Okay. Well, thank you, sir. It was really an informative lecture. And if anybody has any questions regarding the matter, this is the time to ask them.
Mr. Janaka?
Yes.
So you have astronomy and now you have this subject called astrology also.
Yes.
It's a scientific basis for astrology. I think it's an old subject as well.
Yes, exactly. Right. So this is, I mean, those two are actually aligned with each other. So they are astrology also very, very old science, right? It's a very, it's a not a science anyway. It's a kind of a, how do you say that? Yeah, it can, let's say we can say that is a concept or kind of a art or something, right? But it is also based on the movements of the planets and all, right? But we don't call it a science. Both of them are actually going side by side. So some people actually misunderstand about the astronomy and astrology. Some people call for the astronomy, some people call astrology as well. But however, we are not going to predict about the future or past of a person. Like, so it is saying that, okay, what is your future and what is your past based on the movements of the planets and all, the locations of the planets. So that is a kind of, it is also using the same, like a mathematical expressions, like mathematical calculations also. For example, litha kiyala thiyenawane. So that litha means every year they introduce a new litha, lithak introduce karana. So that litha means they exactly calculate the planetary positions also. They put it the planetary positions. Based on those planetary positions, they again calculate their time periods, auspicious times, best times, right? All these things based on those calculations, basically. So anyway, it's a kind of a way they also had some idea about the planetary movements. Clearly, yeah.
Mr. Agasturya, yes. I have a small question. When you showed us some ancient history, to show that mankind was interested in astronomy.
Yeah.
I was expecting to see the three famous pyramids. And because I read somewhere that these three main pyramids have some kind of a ratio in their distances, which is like... it is coinciding with certain distances among three stars.
Yes,
and
exactly.
So I have also heard about the three famous stupas in Sri Lanka. I mean, is that true? Or is there truth to that?
Yeah, I also actually heard about that. Those three pyramids in Giza, they have...
Orion's belt.
Oh, yeah, Orion belts, three stars in Orion belts aligned with the stars in Orion constellation. These are actually written in the books as well. Even that the stupa, three stupa in Anuradhapura, they said they are aligned with that same stars. But actually, I am not sure about that. Those alignments, basically, maybe.
At least the pyramids, I mean.
Yeah. That is. They mentioned that in the different places. They mentioned that they are not just an arbitrary place. They have aligned with the stars in the sky. That is another thing, actually, because you know that in Egypt, the civilization is very old, and not only those three Giza pyramids, there are a lot of other monuments like Abu Simbel, right? The Abu Simbel is another suspect of kind of a monument that just made it by even with some sort of other the help of some other civilization or something. There are a lot of stories, right? Because that technology was unbelievable how that technology actually achieved for 5,000 years ago. So it's a long time back. So if that technology was there, then what happens to that technology? So that's a question. So even you know that 100 years time, we have achieved this much of technology. So then if we had that technology 5,000 years back, then what was happened to that? Then we were not in the same place. We wouldn't have actually end up in this place. We should be in the technology of traveling the space, space travels here. Traveling through the space. So maybe some sort of help actually they have, they might actually get it from some other civilization or maybe somewhere else from the universe or something. So anyway, we don't know exactly, but they are very unusual, these monuments, these buildings and all these things. Still, there are a lot of mystery inside this.
Thank you.
Mr. Adisuriya, this is Dr. Sivakumar. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Thanks for the wonderful talk, man. It's like listening to a story. And it reminds me what Arthur C. Clarke's dream long ago, that you don't need to travel to listen to a person who talks or maybe a conferences. The technology will develop up to that level, staying at home and listening to these wonderful information or maybe the talk like that you gave today.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Just a small question. It may be not maybe appropriate. Number of planets, you know, they identified six that you showed, or maybe eventually increased. How that kind of numbers changed with your timeline? I mean, what was the number they came up with? I mean, by it came to Newton.
If my memory is correct. They have discovered basically Pluto is very late, but Pluto is no longer a planet even right now, right? So there are eight planets at the moment, actually very much later. So when it comes to Newton's time, I think up to maybe Uranus, even I think Uranus, up to Uranus they have discovered. So I'm not exactly sure, because one planet, that is Neptune, was discovered. It is not just discovered by observing, by observations. So it is just discovered by a calculation, right? First, they have said that there should be a planet through a calculation, and then subsequently they just observed there's a planet exactly, that is Neptune. So I'm not sure exactly, Doctor, but maybe up to Uranus they have discovered at that time. So did I ask your question? Answer your question?
Yeah, definitely. So he thought, I mean, he astrology, you know, astronomy, because they are the nine.
Hello, it's not clear. Something, some disturbance is going on. It's not clear. Hello? Hello? I think Dr. Shivakumar disconnected from that line. Yes. Maybe Any other questions?
Questions from the students?
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, now we found that the galaxies are moving past each other at like crazy speeds.
Yeah.
So I was wondering, what was the breaking point discovery for this, and who first discovered it?
Edwin Hubble, right? The universe, the expanding of the universe was discovered Edwin Hubble in 1923 somewhere. Right. So with this first observations, he actually just looked at it and he calculated even the receding speeds of the galaxies, and he found that the further galaxies are moving faster, the galaxies are further, they are moving faster even, right? The galaxies are closer, they are moving slowly. But the further, the speed is more. So then he discovered that the Hubble law even, right? Hubble law, V equals HD. So H is the Hubble constant. So then with that constant, we were able to determine the age of the universe as well. That is 13.8 billion years, the age of the universe. So it is a well established now, but Hubble constant is still revising again and again, Hubble constant, because the understanding and then the day is now every day the technology is increasing and developing, and then we are looking further and further away. So then the telescopes are looking further and further, then the galaxies are also discovering further, then we can calculate the receding speed of the galaxies. So therefore, it is every day it's revising the Hubble constant as well. So when you search in the internet, then you can find out different Hubble constants, but they are very close by each other, those values, but there are different Hubble constants, right? So that was discovered by Edwin Hubble, expanding of the universe.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Sir?
Yeah.
Yeah. I looked out your previous research and all those things, and that you are doing the astroseismology, right?
Yeah, yes, exactly. Yeah.
So I would like to know some basic details about what is astroseismology and about what stars are going. What are you checking?
Yes. Actually, now that is my PhD. Thesis. Now I'm following my PhD right now. So I do my PhD in astroseismology. Astroseismology is a quite, relatively new to the astronomy, right? It's basically not very old part of astronomy. What we are doing here. The seismology is just the Earth. If you take Earth, the word called seismology means the movements, the inside movements of the Earth, like earthquakes and all these things. Study about the earthquakes, the internal movements, how the internal layers actually move inside the Earth. So that is called seismology. So the same thing we apply, we see inside the stars as well. That means the internal changes. Right, so the stars, the star is a very much changed because it is a gas ball, so it cannot be like the freedom of change is very much, than the Earth as a solid object, right? So therefore, if you look at the star, the inside the star, the seismology we do for the pulsating stars, right? Astroseismology is possible for the pulsating stars. Pulsating means the stars are actually variable stars, right? You heard about variable stars. There are two types of variable stars, extrinsic variables and intrinsic variables. Extrinsic variables mean the variability is due to the external object. like a binary system, right? Just covering the one star by another one. So then the light get changed, right? Intrinsic variable star means the variability happens, it happens inside the star because of the internal process. So therefore the star actually then compress and then expand, compress and expand. So therefore it is a variation. This variation is due to the internal changes of the star. More complex systems, the stars actually oscillate asymmetrically. Most of the stars actually oscillate symmetrically, like a radial mode. Radial means symmetrically oscillate, compress and expand, compress and expand. But the stars actually oscillate asymmetrically. That means the north pole may be contract and the south pole expand. It is very unusual. When the north pole contract, so then the south pole might be expanding. So therefore, there is a very complex system will create within the star. So then this is actually due to the internal changes, or we call the instabilities, right? Instabilities of stellar medium. So this the stars start actually get oscillate. So then this oscillation we see in the light curve. When we observe the light curve, these oscillations are there, and we can actually determine the frequency of the oscillations, frequencies. When you get the frequency, then you can tell a lot of things, what is going on inside the star. That is called astroseismology. And this is the only way to look at the star, look at inside the star. Because it is very difficult to see inside the star. It's very difficult. So this is the only way to see what is going on inside the star. So that is called astroseismology.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Okay, I hope that all the college questions are now answered. And thank you again, sir. I would want to mention that there were a lot of students who were willing to come to the lecture today, but unfortunately there was a technical difficulty accessing the account after 6 p.m. So I would like to apologize on behalf of the Astronomy Society for that. And now I would like to invite the Assistant Secretary of the Astronomy Society, Mr. Hasita Samarakkodi, to give a very word of thanks.
Good evening to everyone. I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this event. First and foremost, I express our deepest gratitude to our guest speaker, Mr. Janaka Dasurya, senior research scientist at Arthur C. Clarke Institute for Modern Technologies, who, despite his busy schedule, has found time to grace this event. Thank you, sir, for being here to enlighten us with valuable information on history of astronomy. Next, my sincere thank goes to the head of the Department of Physics, Dr. V.A. Seniviratna, for the generous support to arrange this event. We are grateful to our senior treasurer of the Astronomical Society, Dr. T.P. Ranavaka, for his guidance and the encouragement. Thank you, sir, for your continued support. My heartfelt thanks goes to the lecturers of the Department of Physics for their presence here, accepting our invitation. Also, I would like to thank all the demonstrators for their presence here. I owe special gratitude to the President of the Astronomical Society, Mr. D.A.B. Abekon, and the committee of the Society, who have worked hard to ensure that this event become a success. Finally, I would like to thank all who participated in this lecture for spending your valuable time. Thank you.
Okay, with that, we will be concluding the today's event. And thank you again for everyone who participated in today's event. And until we meet on next time, goodbye from us and stay safe. Thank you.
Goodbye.